New iPhone 17 Pro, new secrets. We're tearing down the iPhone 17 Pro to bring you the inside story and what it means for a repair. Remove the pentalobe screws at the bottom. Heat the screen to soften the adhesive. Use an opening tool with suction cup to create a gap. Apply some alcohol. Use an opening pick to slide along the edges of the iPhone. Open up the iPhone. Remove the display connector bracket. Disconnect the display cable and front sensor cable. Remove the screen. There is a large graphene pad on the back for heat dissipation. Remove the front sensor. The screen is still 6.3 inches, like the 16 Pro. We observe little difference on the screen front. The camera cutout is slightly larger. The flex cable is much wider, and the Touch IC is located on the right. We notice the shield plate is secured by screws, meaning it's removable. They are Torx screws, new screws on an iPhone. There are a total of 14 screws. Flipping up the shield plate, we found the battery is attached to the back. So, we disconnect the battery cable. Remove the shield plate with the battery. The internal components are more densely packed. The motherboard sits horizontally in the middle, likely offering better drop protection. Remove the connector brackets. Disconnect the cables. This cable has two connectors, so it's easier to break. Unscrew the rear camera module and remove it. The rear camera lenses are noticeably larger. The cables are shorter, so use caution when removing. Cover the rear cameras with protective sponge stickers. Remove the front camera module. It also has larger sensors. The flood illuminator and dot projector have swapped places. We swapped the front camera modules between two 17 Pros to test repair assistant compatibility. Fortunately, it passed. Like on 16 Pro, Face ID repair can be done by a front camera replacement. At service history, the status of true depth camera reads used. Remove the top speaker. Disconnect the motherboard cables. Flip over the motherboard. The wireless charging coil cable is still connected. Disconnect the wireless charging coil cable and remove the motherboard. The shape is very different, and it is much smaller. Components and connectors are more densely packed. The motherboard has two extra flex connectors, making it harder to secure with a fixture and more prone to heat damage. The NAND is closer to the A19 Pro chip on the opposite side, with nearly one-third overlapping. This means, heating the NAND for storage upgrades might risk damaging the A19 Pro. Remove the lead R. Unscrew the antenna module. It seems Apple has used more screws and less adhesive, which could be friendly to repairs. Unscrew the SIM tray. Remove the SIM tray. Flip over the SIM card reader and disconnect the cable. Remove the SIM card reader. Unscrew the bottom speaker. Remove the bottom speaker. Then the Taptic engine. Apple definitely has used more screws. Flip over the cable. There are two more screws. Flip over the Taptic engine. Disconnect the cable and remove it. The microphone is separated from the charging port flex cable and is attached to the inner wall of the frame. Removing the charging port flex cable is trickier. There are more screws and an extra extension cable. Still need to apply some alcohol to soften the adhesive. And these two screws at the bottom edge are trickier to access. Remove the charging port flex cable. It is a bigger one piece with an extension cable. The SIM card reader connects to the charging port flex. If the flex fails, the phone could be unable to read the SIM. Heat the back cover. Use an opening tool to create a gap, then slide with an opening pick. It opens up. The charging coil is installed beneath. The middle frame is switched back to aluminum. It is more integrated, with rear camera cutouts and more screw holes. Could be more expensive to replace. The back cover is smaller. It appears the phone can only be opened from the front for a repair. Apple claims the frame is more scratch resistant. We'll see about that. Tweezers and a screwdriver left visible scratches, while the key caused only very light marks. We had to install the shield plate with the battery back, as we were trying to apply current to release the adhesive. Place the positive probe on the silver tab on the battery, and the negative probe on the screw. Apply 9 volts DC voltage, and the battery can be easily removed. We verified later that it was not necessary to reinstall the shield plate to release the battery with electrical charge. This is the new vapor chamber. The battery still uses a steel case. The capacity is 3,998 mAh, up by 416. With all the parts out, let's see if repair is easier or harder.